Hi, this is Dr. Rudresh. Welcome to my channel Medical Microbiology Guide. Today I am discussing on the antigen. Antigen is defined as a foreign substance which, when introduced parenterally, stimulates the production of the antibody which reacts with the antigen specifically and in an observable manner. So the word parenteral means outside the intestinal tract, something like intradermal, subcutaneous or intravenous. There are some characteristics for an antigen. The antigen must have immunogenicity, that is the capacity to induce the immune response, and also it should have the immunological reactivity, that is it's going to react with the specific antibody. So based on the immunological reactivity, the antigens will be classified into two types, that is a complete antigen and an hapten. A complete antigen, it induces the formation of corresponding antibody and it reacts with the antibody specifically and also in an observable manner. And if you compare it with the hapten, hapten is actually an incomplete antigen. Okay, so most of the university exams, hapten is asked as a 3-mark question. So here the hapten is a substance which is capable of combining with the antibody, but it cannot itself stimulate the production of an antibody. So a hapten is a very small molecule, hence it does not meet the optimum size of an antigen which is required for processing and presentation by antigen presenting cell. Hence if you want to make a hapten into a complete antigen, then we have to combine the hapten with a carrier molecule to make it a complete antigen. So haptens can be a complex hapten, so which can precipitate with the specific antibodies, that is it's having multivalent, or it can be a simple hapten which is a non-precipitating hapten. Okay, it's or univalent. So let's see two more terms, epitope and paratope. Epitope is the smallest unit of antigenicity on the antigen. Okay, so this is the antigenic determinant of an antigen. Okay, or I can say this is a site where the antibody will come and bind, or this is a site against which the antibodies are produced. So this is called as an epitope. So usually an epitope will be a small area on the antigen, say around 4 to 5 amino acids can combine to form an epitope. So it has the capacity of stimulating an immunocyte and also react with the complementary site on the antibody. So epitopes, there are two types. One is a linear or sequential epitope, another is a conformational epitope. So you can see here the conformational epitope means different amino acids which are located at different points in the peptide chain, they come together and they form a conformational epitope which is recognized by the antigen presenting cell, or it can combine with the corresponding antibody. So this conformational epitopes are recognized by B cells. Okay, so that means to say the amino acids participating in the conformational epitopes, actually they are in different positions. With a three-dimensional folding of the protein, the amino acids will come together to form an epitope. So if you stretch a peptide chain, so your the epitope is going to be destroyed. In case of the T cell epitope, the amino acids will be there in the sequence. So T cell epitope is always a linear epitope, whereas B cell epitope is a conformational epitope. So the antigen binding area on the antibody is called as the paratope. So now we understood the two terms. One is the epitope is nothing but that is the antigenic determinant, and paratope is an area of antibody where the epitope will bind. Now we'll see what are the determinants of antigenicity. So as I already told, the size of an antigen is very important to be an antigen. So if we have a very low molecular weight substance, okay, so that acts as an hapten rather than an antigen. Usually high molecular weight molecules are more antigenic compared to the low molecular weight molecules. So but the low molecular weight molecules can be made antigenic by attaching them with a carrier protein. And also chemical nature of the antigen, it matters a lot for its antigenicity. Protein antigens are always more immunogenic compared to polysaccharide antigens, and polysaccharide antigens are more immunogenic compared to lipids. Lipids are more immunogenic compared to nucleic acids. So proteins which are composed of 20 amino acids are more antigenic, and not all proteins are antigenic. Example, so gelatin, which actually it lacks the structural instability, hence the different shapes of the individual gelatin molecules will not stimulate the immune system, hence it becomes non-immunogenic. So susceptibility to tissue enzymes is a very important aspect, because the antigen which enters into the body has to be metabolized, and then it has to be processed, and then it has to be submitted to the T cells for further identification. And also, if the antigen is related, the antigenicity will be less. So that is nothing but the antigenicity is directly proportional to the degree of foreignness. So an unknown antigen is more immunogenic compared to a related antigen. So generally the antigens of the same species are less immunogenic than the antigens of related species, and then these are less antigenic compared to antigens from a distant species. Antigenic specificity is nothing but the change in the overall configuration of it changes the antigenicity. So that is why the consistent three-dimensional conformation is required for an antigen to be to show an efficient antigenicity. So due to some phylogenetic relationships, the individuals in a species, there exists some degree of the cross reaction. So this is the species specificity with respect to antigen, and this is usually used for tracing the evolutionary relationship between the species, and also for the forensic identification of the species of the blood in the crime areas. And also isospecificity, antigens which are found in the same but not all the members of the species. So example, the blood group antigens. So it is we should know this, the kind of isospecificity for the sake of this grouping and cross matching, all those things. Autospecificity, some of the self antigens which are generally non-antigenic can become antigenic if they are exposed in the future part of life. Say for example, some of the sequestered antigens like lens antigens, sperm antigens, so the brain tissue, So actually usually they are protected by the barriers, or they are encapsulated so that they are not exposed to the immature or developing immune system in the infancy, so that the immune system is not trying to handle such antigens, and such antigens acts as the more antigenic compared to the other antigens which are already primed for with the lymphocytes. Again, some of the organs such as brain, kidney, lens protein, again there are the that's what I told, hidden or sequestered antigens. So of the different species can have the same antigen. Say for example, the earlier the neural vaccines derived from the sheep brain, which was given for rabies. So the sheep brain proteins, antibodies produced against the sheep brain proteins, lead to cross react with the antigens produced antigens of the human brain, leading to encephalitis. Then there is a terminology called as heterophile specificity or heterogenetic specificity. Here a same or closely related antigens may sometimes occur in a two different biological species or classes or kingdoms. These are known as the heterophile antigens. Example is a Forssman antigen. So Forssman antigen is nothing but lipid carbohydrate complex which is widely distributed in the animal, birds, plant and bacteria. Weil-Felix test for typhus fever, here the protease O antigens will cross react with the rickets cell antigens. So that is again totally a different species actually. And also Paul-Bunnell test in case of infectious mononucleosis, Cold-Agglutinin test in case of primary atypical pneumonia due to mycoplasma. I think so that finishes the antigen chapter. Hope you have understood. If there is any comments, please put it in the comments below. Please subscribe to my channel, like this video, and don't forget to press the bell button so that you will get updated with the new videos which I upload.